very much to everyone for coming. Welcome. Thank you for joining us at the annual Harry C. Howard Jr. Lecture. In 1994, this lectureship was established by an endowment made by Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Nash Jr. and Mr. and Mrs. George Renfro, and they sought to honor their lifelong friend, an alumnus of Vanderbilt, Harry C. Howard Jr. So this is a lecture series born in friendship, and that strikes me as a great thing. Their generous and visionary gift allows an outstanding scholar to deliver a lecture on a significant topic in the humanities each year. We've been very fortunate to host many distinguished lectures over the years, and tonight is no different. The study of the humanities is integral to this university, and it has an enduring, and I would say, you might get to see my dance moves any minute now. And I would say an increasingly important place beyond the academy as well. So I'm very grateful to have the outstanding partner of the Robert Penn Warren Center for the Humanities in championing the work of humanities on this campus and beyond. And I'd like to welcome Professor Edward Friedman, Faculty Director of the Warren Center, and Gertrude Conway, Vanderbilt Professor of Spanish and Professor of Comparative Literature. Professor Friedman.
Thank you very much for being here. We thank Dean Benton and the College of Arts and Science for your support. And as always, we thank the Nash and Renfro families for honoring Mr. Harry C. Howard, Jr. On behalf of Mona Frederick, the Executive Director of the Robert Penn Warren Center for the Humanities at Vanderbilt, and the staff of the Warren Center, it is my great pleasure to introduce the speaker for this year's Harry C. Howard, Jr. Lecture, Quiara Alegría Hudes. When we were considering whom to invite for this year's lecture, previous speakers have included scholars, artists, and dignitaries in a variety of fields. We thought of figures from the world of theater. I mentioned that among other playwrights, I had been intrigued by the work of Quiara Alegría Hudes. And Mona noted that 2017 marks the 100th anniversary of the Pulitzer Prizes. We also recognize that Vanderbilt University has a relatively new program in Latino and Latina studies. That thought process has led us to today, and we are most grateful to Ms. Hudes for accepting the invitation. With degrees from Yale and Brown, with a strong background in music as well as in theater, Ms. Hudes seems never to have ceased to engage in creative activities, which have brought her recognition and a broad range of honors. She continues to write at high speed, and she's currently the Shapiro Distinguished Professor of Writing and Theater at Wesleyan University. In trying to keep up, as it were, with contemporary U.S. theater, I read and was fascinated by Elliot, A Soldier's Feud, part of what was to be a trilogy of plays and a finalist for the 2007 Pulitzer Prize for Drama. This is a play that treats, uniquely and penetratingly, the themes of war, generations, and ethnic identity. It was followed by Water for the Spoonful, which was awarded the Pulitzer Prize for Drama in 2012, which accentuates the after effects of military service, reintegration into society, addiction and technology, again in a style that's highly distinctive. The third play, The Happiest Song Plays Last, which I had a chance to see at the Goodman Theater in Chicago in 2013, deals with family, inevitable transitions, points of contact between life and art, and means of communication that are both facilitated and complicated by technological advances. During these years, Quiara Alegría Hudes wrote the book for the musical In the Heights, with music and lyrics by Lin-Manuel Miranda, he of Hamilton fame. In the Heights, rather immortal in its own right, is an innovative work in terms of story and music about establishing a sense of community based on multiple backgrounds and prior experiences, and ultimately finding home, sometimes in unexpected places. It was nominated for a Pulitzer Prize and for 13 Tony Awards, receiving 4 Tonys, including Best Musical of 2008. I won't mention all the plays of Quiara Alegría Hudes, but I will say that I would recommend Yamaya's Belly as a superb take on the American dream, and 26 Miles as a commentary on family dynamics, ethnicity, and love. I have avoided addressing Ms. Hudes' biography per se because I believe that her background will be part of her talk, titled A Writer's Many Selves. Please join me in welcoming this year's Howard Lecturer, Quiara Alegría Hudes.
All right, let's turn this on. I'm cheating because I made them talk over the music, but I'm not going to. Okay, can everyone hear me all right? Great, so we're going to start with a little audience participation. Trust me, it won't be long. Since you won't be able to flip back and forth to an index, I'm going to go through a few vocabulary words, okay? Just three of them. The first one is bruja. Can I hear everyone say bruja?
Bruja.
It means witch. Okay. The second vocabulary word is lukumi. That's lukumi. Can I hear everyone say that? Lukumi. That's an Afro-Caribbean religious path. It syncretizes Catholicism of the Spanish colonialists with West African Yoruba cosmology. And the last word is septa. Can I have everyone say septa?
Septa.
It's public transportation in Philadelphia. All right. Part 1, 4th of July. We were loud Latinas from 8 months to 88 years, crammed into a teeny kitchen like dancing sardines. The 3300 block of North American Street was two-story row homes with front porches and cement stoops. Inside Abuela's house, the music blasted and the asses bounced with as though this slice of North Philly was the whole world owned by us. The universe conducted by our hips and spandex-clad tetas. Frizzy hair cut short, bangs teased into stiff clouds, sweat glistening in the summer fog, pamper butt babies weaving between legs. Even dinner danced, tap, 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 as simmering arroz compelled the lid into movement. The jeans were unapologetically 80s, acid washed, pleated waist tapered so tight your ankles went numb. Neon block print blouses with shoulder pads, high waist shorts, midriffs were in, and ours were on display. There was an utter cheapness to these clothes, our humble budgets stretched like bungee cables, but barrio style has no price tag. Some chose baggy, some fitting. Abuela's house dress fell to mid-calf. Nyanya's jean skirt showed a sliver of panty. Mija's hips tested the capacity of spandex. Homegirl's curves had curves. She was tall enough to cast a shadow across the room, and for added elevation, her bangs were teased to double height. Her imposing frame seemed to be in the living room, dining room, at once. Mija didn't so much walk as bounce, and menacingly so, with angularity. The subtlest dance moves rendered on her figure became acts of aggression. If Mija was moving in your direction, the way. Her eyes were sunken with perpetual exasperation, as though she was wronged by the world's intrepid existence. Some shit was always going wrong, and her limbs shook away the grievances. Her towering majesty and righteous thighs were a biological dare. Try not to look. Try not to smile. Try not to feel just a wee bit violated. 2 years later, addiction would render her imposing frame skeletal. She would become a walking dagger. But for now, the spandex was tight and right. White sports bra, plastic hoop earrings, white, everything white except her café con leche skin and the eleques protection beads circling her neck, because she was on the path to being a bruja, the good kind, the lukumi kind, the Afro-Caribbean kind. She had brought all her babies along, and they were fixed to our hips like tool belts. Teens held babies, kids held babies, bow-legged babies, pamper butt babies, grumpy toddlers frowning on the steps. Abuela's house came with built-in childcare, so Mija. Mary Lou boasted fewer curves. A wooden rosary pointed down to her cleavage with a holy wink, but mostly it was her joy, not her figure, that was outrageous. She gyrated with sinuous abandon, head to toe, a happy that was infectious, that needed no café con leche, a happy that woke up that way and let loose on the world. Rejoice was Mary Lou's evergreen mask. With a huge smile, mid-salsa step, she proclaimed she was moving to Florida, porque aquí no vale, because North Philly's no good. If she hated the neighborhood, she had a cheerful way of showing it. Mary Lou chased Mija's babies around the plastic-covered sofas, planting an embarrassment of kisses on their foreheads, tutoring them how to do the butt. Do the diaper, she goaded, as they obliged or cried. Either way, we cracked up and applauded. I'll never understand why, despite her ferocious fun, she was nasty and punishing toward her only child. Ashley was 4 at the time, and in my memory, Mary Lou is cutting her down with razor eyes and one or two hissed words, even while dancing with Mija's pamper butt babies. Maybe it was that love strictness, that protective strictness some urban parents cling to. I will not let these blocks make a mess of my child. It was a strictness that originated in striving and ambition, but had grown into other kinds, like I'm tired as shit, and life ain't working out good, and these blocks be getting me down strictness. Just a year later, Mary Lou's limbs would lay still as stone, an aneurysm knocking her to the floor at age 24. She may have shone bright as a string of Christmas lights, but she fell quick as a fresh-cut tree. Ashley would grow up motherless, that strictness a phantom voice, her compass lost to the stormy sea of North Philly girlhood. Titi Rosa climbed the stairs to splash cold water on her face. She was already large by this 4th of July, but would soon be too massive to get up from the sofa. Having your husband die at 40 and 2 kids die in their 20s will do that to you. You gotta do something with all that sorrow, might as well eat it. But for now, before those deaths, she was almost spry on those narrow, crooked steps. Maybe, I imagined, she was sneaking into Abuela's room and copping a look at the legendary X-rated playing cards. Each one boasted a different naked man, black and brown beauties captured in nature, leaning on rocks, splashing in waterfalls, their large, flaccid members arranged in scenic repose. My gin rummy skills peaked that summer. Abuela shuffled around the stove, always cooking, a perpetual motion machine, always in relation to the teeny kitchen, always with an offer. Quiere café? Quiere pan sobao? Magnets of tropical produce, pineapples, avocados, ears of corn, they crammed the fridge like a little plastic farmer's market. As a joke, the cousins shoved a 40 of Budweiser into Abuela's hand and snapped a photo. Anything to render the wrinkled saint a slight badass. They goaded her, flip the bird for the camera. But she refused, blushing. At the last minute, she flipped 2 birds. They got the shot. Abuela's elderly wrinkle of a sister, Tia Moncha, lived in the adjacent row home. They were a duo of shrinking matriarchy, losing altitude each year to osteoporosis. Who knew how old they actually were? They had looked ancient since age 40. These wrinkled, gray-haired majesties shuffled toward each other in a giggling embrace, their identical frizzy buns in stereo as they passed ingredients through the backyard fence. You need some rice? You're out of cornmeal? Toma, coge el teléfono, it's the cousins from Puerto Rico. How far they had migrated. Leaving tropical farms, leaving rows of fibrous yuca and ñame unharvested, to be side by side in this urban mayhem. Listening to the conversation, you might want to wear earplugs. Indoor voice for us meant deafening. You might think Spanish and English were one language. They rolled in and out of each other like wrestlers locking limbs. Where did one language begin and the other end? Most days like this one, my body sat still. Mine was a dance of the eyes and ears, watching, wondering what a life that corporeal must feel like. This wonderful scandal was not my family so much as my personal thriving novel, a world vibrant as the Shakespeare and George Orwell that kept me flipping pages all summer long. I had never read a book quite like this living room, and yet I savored every detail in the same manner I savored Jonathan Swift. Delicious contradictions, heaps of pulsing language, The thrill of peeking into uncharted terrain, even in its unwritten form, Abuela's Living Room was the wildest book I'd ever cracked open. Plus, it was cheaper than a SEPTA token to the library. Balling on a budget, my cousin said when they found Sega cartridges at the Salvation Army. To me, these parties were bargains of the highest order. In eighth grade English and in Abuela's Living Room, I had the privilege of spying on life, if not the courage to step onto the actual dance floor. Where had the men gone, I wondered. Had we scared them off with our lipsticks and hair bleaches? Had a Philly breeze blown all the men away? The men who had managed to stick around had no interest in these estrogen fests. Instead, Theo George dragged his equipment and cooler to the ball fields of Hunting Park. His sons, Elliot and Sean, explored that enormous parcel of land until George's piercing whistle called them to home plate. Between games, the players ate binchos and washed down the meat with Coors Light, Budweiser, or if payday had come, Heineken. George always left the last bit of beer in his can for his two boys. It was probably all backwash anyway. As per ballpark box, and the salsa mix that year featured Johnny Rivera singing, "No vale la pena de enamorarse," falling in love isn't worth the pain. Not an inspiring lyric for the ladies of American Street. Where had Odette gone, I wondered. In the space between me just clapping and Mary Lou's titty shakes, I caught a phantom trace of their little sister. A year earlier, Odette would have been weaving among us, smacking butts and yelling, "Wepa!" She always dragged me onto the dance floor, "Come on, Kiki!" And she'd yank my hand, and I would abandon myself for a few minutes, because to Odette, the object of dancing was laughter, not grace. My awkwardness became an asset when Odette took the lead. In her absence, I remained on the steps, an observer. But her memory was a murky itch, tapping my shoulder, whispering, "Yoo-hoo." It had happened a year ago, though it still burned my throat like fresh tar. I had been watching TV on Abuela's sofa, my sweaty hair sticking to the plastic-covered cushions. A ruckus exploded upstairs. There were many varieties of ruckus back then, but this one was unfamiliar. A baby crying, Odette's voice suddenly demonic, shouting, "Shut up!" And then a brief series of thuds that echoed, that rang out like metal bells. What had begun as a bath for her youngest, Sean, had become a wig out of the highest order. I trained my eyes on the TV and covered my ears. When you hear a lot of fights, you learn to cover your ears without using your hands. Soon aunts were called, elders were storming up and down the stairs, and Odette, it was determined, was to get the fuck out and clean up. They cradled little Sean, held ice to his head, sobbing and cursing, thick in strategy. Plan part one, Odette's two sons, Elliot and Sean, would be adopted by Titi Ginny and Theo George. Plan part two, Jessie, her daughter, would stay at Abuela's house. The aunts made these decisions in thick, quick Spanish, an attempt to shield us youngins from the obvious. Odette had gone berserk, coked out, zombie-ass crazy. It seemed impossible, despite what my own ears had heard. My Odette, my older cousin with a laugh warm as September sun, had been plucked from sanity and blown to chaos, like a dandelion seed on the devil's breeze. The terrible ruckus had been 1989, but now it was 1990, and Sean and Elliot were running the path of Hunting Park, Odette was who knows where, and Juan Luis Guerra had come out with Bachata Rosa, a merengue album so romantic, our hips were incapable of stillness. Marrow deep, mitochondrial, was our need to embody those songs, those Spanish lyrics of forbidden love and wedding proposals. Juan Luis Guerra wove us into a braid of song. High clarion trumpets, trendy synth hits, Afro-pop vocals, our old world and new world and middle passage commemorated on cassette. In his lyrics, our lives were rejoiced, poor and working people who loved hard. We played that tape until it melted in the radio. Then we bought a new one. We played the second tape until the deck broke off, and then we duct taped it closed. Being physical was our family ethic. We touched each other into existence. We pinched each other into the material world, as though making sure it wasn't all a dream. Arms around shoulders, salsa spins, kisses to foreheads and bellies, cheek kisses, hello and goodbye, huddling together for family photos. Scientists call it skin to skin. We called it cariñoso. This was not unique to the dance parties. At church, in ceremony, in repose, at bingo night. We bore witness to each other's earthly form with fingers, arms, foreheads, a laying on of hands. Had it happened in utero or earlier in the primordial mud? Exactly when was each Perez woman set to motion? Was it after we were pushed into this material world of boomboxes and Fourths of July? Our dancing resembled electrons and protons, some of us with positive charge, others with negative, circling and orbiting until the space between us became matter itself. That's how atoms work. All that space, all the distance in between is our tactile world. Reach out and touch the openness, the charge. And so the spaces between our footsteps became our material existence, our fleshy lineage. The transatlantic displacements, the indigenous and African and Canary Island ancestry, the Orishas and Catholic saints were passed from spin to spin, from step to step. If our hips could speak, they'd tell a history. There were no symposiums on us, no annotated bibliographies. We hadn't earned a margin in some history book. There weren't agendas or memos involved in our moves. There were shifty gatherings, too, cropping up at unexpected moments. Depending on your angle of observation, the scene itself would shape-shift. Watch from the sofa, you'd witness exultation. Watch from the stairs, you'd see defiance and protest. Watch as I do now, 27 years later, and you'd see women staving off sorrow. The clues were around us and growing daily. T-cell counts were lowering, elders disappearing into bathrooms to snort bumps of coke. That 4th of July, we bumped hips at the brink of loss, as Juan Luis Guerra cured us. Press play on his tape and you paused the outside world. His merengue was our reset button, our baptism. Part two, DJ circumstance. The halls of Central High had tan tile and metal doors. Cork boards displayed student charcoal drawings and Langston Hughes poems. The literature I read there opened labyrinths in my mind. Some of these paths led to sunlit rooms, others to entire new worlds of thought, still others to haunted places. Death of a Salesman, it rattled me. What right did this Arthur Miller dude have to pluck his hero from the midst of a scene and deposit him into the jagged menace of memory? The way Arthur Miller sliced into natural conversation with refracted vignettes disoriented me, as the familiar often does. Willie Loman's tale of decline felt like the story of my birth dad, a Jewish carpenter who had left me and mom years ago for a white family in the suburbs. As it turned out, a paler, posher demographic did not fill the emptiness in Dad's heart. Despite ongoing evidence to the contrary, Dad remained sure that some middle-class fantasy was his birthright, and he became increasingly dejected when this destiny eluded him. Ugh, I seethed at Willie Loman. I would slam down that book with bitter recognition. Back then, I only battled with books I loved. It aggravated me how the Loman family suffered so baldly in the face of hardship. Sure, Willie and Sons threw a football or two, but mostly they all just fretted and lamented. It seemed so wan, so lacking in dynamics. Hamlet brooded, Romeo beat his chest, Willie Loman went mad. Why don't they all dance their asses off like the Perez women? Live a little, dudes! Play a salsa tape or something. It's not like these literary heroes had a monopoly on misery. All my cousins sucked a different kind of bitterness from their teeth. There were so many shades to the bitter coals we chewed on. The bitterness of living in blight. The bitterness of alcoholism, the bitterness of unknown fathers. If people were punctuation, our fathers would be the question marks. The bitterness of siblings redistributed to other houses, the bitterness of being the second generation that did so much worse than the first. Even the saints among us who spent a life in service of others let years of bitterness accumulate under their fingernails like dirt. Bitterness this is a ball that doesn't stop bouncing. It just keeps on hitting different walls, taking unpredictable angles and routes. But at least we danced. You know, Willie Loman should have learned a merengue. Now, by sophomore year, I had developed a uniform that married my bohemian sensibility with my feminist self-defense. Floral dresses, motorcycle boots, and two chopsticks securing a frizzy French twist. All right, piano lessons often kept me out late after school, and my long moonlit trek from the bus stop led me through dark, empty streets. So if anyone messed with me, I'd kick him in the nuts with my steel-toe boots and jab him in the eye with my chopsticks. This would loosen my French twist so my hair would tumble down in triumph as I fled the scene. It was an ill-conceived fashion concept. The first time I was messed with was in broad daylight. A kid held a razor to my neck and whispered, almost sexy-like, "Give me all your money or I swear I'll cut your throat." Should I kick him in the nuts? Should I poke him in the eye? I did neither. Nope, I talked that kid out of cutting me. I convinced him it was a bad idea. Rhetoric was my self-defense. Take that, Taekwondo. Shit gave new meaning to street smarts. My other daily accessory was a black suede backpack filled with library books and my Norton anthology. At 14 years old, my neck muscles were twisted under this daily load. My mom's homemade elixir of sage-infused rubbing alcohol burned with menthol coolness as she massaged my knotty back. Sometimes she forked over the cash for a chiropractic adjustment. But the chiropractor gave me the same prescription each session, fewer books. I listened to him like water stays in a basket. One day, the phone in my English class rang and I was summoned to the principal's office. My dress that day was red with white flowers and it flounced against my knees as my boots echoed through the hallways. The principal puffed on his corncob pipe and sheets of smoke haloed around him. He glanced my way with efficient pity and suggested I call home. There were three wooden phone booths in the hall. My first quarter was returned, no answer at home. On the second call, the phone clicked and my quarter was swallowed. It was Abuela's house. Screams in the background, cries. I was informed that Mary Lou was dead. The SEPTA platform was a surreal kind of quiet. During after-school hours, that stop was a carnival of chaos, but now at midday, to the lone student on the platform, it seemed a limbo world, cavernous and moist as a grotto. Water dripped in surround sound echoes, leaving mineral outlines on the wall pooling by the tracks. Though SEPTA rides offered prime reading time, Death of a Salesman remained squirreled in my backpack. Instead, my jaw clamped down hard, biting a question away. Central High was a magnet school. It lured kids from all over the city. Why did classmates from other neighborhoods not have my same funeral count? What was wrong with the Perez's, I tried not to ask. What were we dying of? Stations passed as I neared the wailing, the rosaries, the barrage of morning rituals that always struck me as monstrous and alienating. Screaming and chest pounding would alternate with whispered prayers, a loud, soft whiplash that would continue for weeks. It was Titi Rosa's third major loss this year, and her lungs had expanded like a marathon runner's for all the grieving. I braced myself for a deafening night of bereavement. Mostly, I sat in the corner and watched. No one ate, which was for my family was supremely creepy. A metal tray with Ritz crackers went untouched, and the Gouda grew waxy as the afternoon heat bore down. A pot of café might have been brewed, but otherwise the stovetop sat cold. Soon the Brooklyn cousins would arrive, mascara smeared, shaking their heads and passing around tissues. Soon bouquets and wreaths would transform Abuela's living room into a wilting topiary. Years earlier, to mark my position as miniature bride at Mary Lou's wedding, my mom had sewn me a magnificent white gown. Soon I would visit St. Ambrose Christ Church again, this time dressed in black, head to toe. And we'd drive the streets of North Philly, a motorcade of orange funeral stickers. But tonight, the rosary must be started. Abuela's usual admonition, in or out, make a choice, went unheeded that night. The screen door slammed in constant announcement, neighbors and family cycling through, praying, having a quiet smoke on the porch. Ashley slumped in the corner, sofa corner, numb, disoriented, no doubt replaying the scene from earlier that day. She heard her mom scream, ran downstairs and discovered Mary Lou flat on the kitchen floor, a half-spilled cereal box in her hand. Everyone patted Ashley's head or scooped her into embraces. Finally, her dad showed up and took her away unceremoniously. "Let's go." No need to linger while Rosa wailed upstairs. When Ginny arrived, little Sean took my hand and looked me into the eye. "I'm sorry for your loss, Geeky," was his greeting. At 8 years old, he was an experienced griever. Just weeks before, Mary Lou had come over to babysit. She brought along Ashley, who gnawed on a wide plastic straw, sucking Mountain Dew like Dom Perignon, as though her ass had been kissed by Queen Elizabeth. That big gulp was the size of Ashley's torso, and it beaded in the oppressive heat. With the sole intention of pissing her off, I took a sip and delivered a prolonged, breathy, Ashley's face twisted with injustice when she registered my delicious insult. Pouting and stomping, she shrieked, "That's my soda! Geeky drank my soda!" But this little bit of brattiness ignited some primal rage in Mary Lou, whose nostrils flared and voice sliced like a machete. "Your soda? In this family, there's no such word as your. Sit your greedy ass down." All this with a raised hand, a pre-slapped hand. I insisted it was fine. I didn't even like Mountain Dew. I was just messing with Ashley. But Mary Lou forced us into a cross-legged ceremonial circle and made us take turns sipping. A disciplinary round of pass the cup. Now Ashley wanted no part in the big gulp. She pushed it away, her long curls falling over her face. She shook her head in protest, wiping errant tears with a quick fist. Mary Lou spoke through clenched teeth, through tight lips. "You're going to drink that damn soda, Ashley, or we will leave right now and never come back to Kika's house again. Tu me entiende? I ain't raising no spoiled brat. I will ain't teach none of us that way." And so Ashley sipped, training her stink eye on the living room floor, and so progressed the punitive proceedings. Well, on the fourth round, Mary Lou's eyes turned inquisitive. Poised to sip, she instead opened her mouth as a Jurassic belch tornadoed from her lungs. Its power seemed to surprise even her. In the belch's wake, the chandelier crystals jingled a bit. Soon, Mary Lou was teaching us to burp the ABCs. Ashley and I could barely force out an A, but Mary Lou burped all the way to M with some melody to boot. By the time the cup was empty, we were gasping for breath between hoots and howls. "I peed my panties," Mary Lou admitted. "Me too," Ashley smiled. "Well, I hadn't peed." "Then you weren't having fun, Geeky," Mary Lou protested. "You're too uptight, Geeky." The first night's rosary was over. Mom had an aura of calm driving home through the empty streets. Philly had gone to bed. Mom took the long way home, forgoing the expressway, weaving through residential blocks, lingering too long after traffic lights changed. "Mom, it's green. You can go now." Girard Avenue, even at night, felt like an event horizon. Wealth and want converged at this intersection. Just north of Girard, blight. Just south, brownstones and polished brass. Mom's circuitous, vaguely southbound route deposited us on Mount Vernon Street, the block she had first lived on in Philly when she was 12. Even in the darkness, the block boasted architectural updates, pristine American flags, motion sensor streetlights. Professors and judges had restored the homes to their historic single-family design, and the Perezes had joined a Puerto Rican migration deeper north into smaller row homes made of less sturdy goods. City Hall's lit clock was a midnight moon, and William Penn shone atop the tower, our city's bronze sentinel. "Mom, what's an aneurysm?" I hadn't asked in the midst of the wailing. "A blood clot in the brain." "What causes it?" "Genetics." "Was it preventable?" Mary Lou's brain was a ticking clock, and none of us had a clue. The answer brought some small relief. An accident of fate, a genetic marker, seemed a death that might happen in any city or suburb, to any family, rich or poor. It was a tragic way to go, but not sociologically complicated. Mary Lou, age at death, 24. Maybe in Mom's fatigue, she would let a little truth slip. Maybe midnight was the hour of answers. I risked another question. "Mom, what did Big June die of?" "Kidney failure." "Why did his kidneys fail?" "Dialysis doesn't last forever, sweetheart." "But what put him on dialysis in the first place?" "He swallowed too many ibuprofen." Like Advil? What kind of headache did he have? He was a big guy and took more pills than he needed. But he wasn't big at the end, he was skin and bones. Look, Mom paused. June may have had AIDS. May have? I don't know, Kiara. Ask your titi Rosa. She gives me a different answer every time. Well, how did he get AIDS? The dialysis, probably, she said. Mom. There are words that have willpower that compel you not to speak them aloud. Was Big June shooting up? Was he using dirty needles? She didn't respond. Big June, age of death, 22. What about Mijal? Did he OD on Advil too? I asked. She seemed unmoved by my sarcasm. No, she sighed. He had AIDS. How'd he get it? No response came. Mijal, age at death, 40. Whatever it was, this plague that hit my family hard, it would remain unnamed for another night. My evidence for a universal conspiracy against the Perezes was anecdotal at best. Nonetheless, I vastly preferred how Mary Lou had passed, in a manner no one seemed ashamed to speak out loud. I rolled down the window so the breeze would pummel my face and outstretched palm. The river beside us reflected a black sky brightened by the twinkling lights of Boathouse Row. Our usually loud radio remained switched off. So, this was the soundtrack to our soundtrack. This was what DJ Circumstance was spinning in the background behind all that Juan Luis Guerra. Silence. Should we drive to the top of the art museum steps? Mom asked, flicking on the blinker. She busted her best Boricua U-turn and navigated up the curving roadway toward the museum's monumental sand-colored columns. Continuing past the parking lots roped off end, Mom stopped her car atop the steps themselves. Driving onto the pedestrian plaza was her favorite late-night rebellion. There beyond us twinkled the city of brotherly love. Somewhere in that distant cluster of lights, a founding father had written about self-evident truths. But I had no faith in self-evidence of any kind. Linda Lohman's words swirled in the darkness. Attention must be paid. Things ought to be spoken aloud, I thought. Lives written down. I missed my cousin. Part 3, Blood Sacrifice. There was a turtle in the bathtub. It scratched all night, fluttering taps as it tried to scale the bathtub walls. Its poops were an annoyance, but this incessant clawing? It was not introduced as a pet and had no name as far as I could tell. I accepted it as another incongruous fact of life and began showering in the downstairs tub. One night, months later, I was startled awake by the house's sudden quiet, aware of how deep my sleep had been. I crept out of bed and peeked into the bathroom. The turtle was gone. There was a goat in the basement. I'd been hopping down the steps to grab my bike and was stopped cold in my tracks. There it stood, guileless and bearded, hooves on the cement floor, glancing up as though this encounter were natural, even fanciful. I backed up the stairs, closed the door gently, and decided to ride my bike another day. You should have a sleepover this weekend, my mom suggested casually, but not here, at a friend's house. I spent Saturday night gorging on Cool Ranch Doritos, watching Do the Right Thing, and painting my toenails and playing penny ante poker. Returning home Sunday night, a sleepy mess, I collapsed on the living room sofa. But those goaty horns and hooves, those keyhole eyes kept nudging me from slumber. I walked across the living room, turned the basement doorknob carefully, and tiptoed down a few steps. My breath was thick. The goat was gone. There was a cage in the backyard holding a chicken. Its limp comb and flaccid wattle were a sickly red, its beak a pale pink triangle. White feathers wailed at the metal bars as the chicken thrashed and rested and thrashed again, injuring itself with each new protest. I stared it down, then slowly inched closer so as not to startle the bird, wondering how I might open that cage without getting my fingers pecked. Thrash, quiet, tiptoe. Thrash, quiet, tiptoe. We established a cautious groove. Finally, I reached out, the chicken joining my dubious silence. I unlatched the door with a click, and now the awful beak was on my fingers, the wings a violent whup and whirl. I darted back up the steps, past the first floor landing, past the second floor landing, all the way to my third floor bathroom, where I closed the door and cursed my mother in silence. The chicken had not broken my skin, nor had I freed it. Each of Mom's late night ceremonies, I approached in this manner, my heart pounding in reluctant steps, hand reaching toward a non-existent escape hatch. The batad drums would drift upstairs, jangling me from the latest episode of The Simpsons or whatever Pink Floyd tape I was playing, where I had once been a delirious spy reveling in ass shakes and Juan Luis Guerra. Now I peeked around corners, a terrified voyeur. Even as I disavowed each Lukumi ceremony, my thick was my compulsion to see what scared me the most. Was it God I feared? Was it the metallic scent of sacrifice, or how blood ran dark as tar in our dimly lit living room? Was it the final screaming plea and quick hush of death? I suspected that this was no choice, but something rooted in Mom at birth, therefore indicting me as well. Were her ceremonies hiding in my marrow? In junior year English class, witches were the dregs, the wet coffee grounds of humanity. They were shrews who made potions from frog poop and fire. They cackled atonally from crook-nosed wart faces. Witches were the low-hanging literary fruit against which Arthur Miller's heroes were deemed right and good. Murderous Macbeth had a conscience. The witches just had bubbling cauldrons. Philandering John Proctor believed in honesty and due process. The Salem girls had no intellects to temper their hysteria. William Shakespeare and Arthur Miller were powerhouses of rational aesthetics, of complex reasoning. Witches occupied the opposite quadrant of the literary grid, instinctive, female, corporeal, a floor above which thinking men were surely the ceiling. It was unanimously reported that witches had actual powers, therefore the work of ethics of reason would never be complete. My junior year English teacher made us perform Abigail Williams and the Three Witches in an oral exam turned monologue battle. Highest marks went to the shrillest cackler. "When shall we three meet again?" she modeled for us, her voice a pinched shriek. I responded in monotone, refusing to squawk. "When shall we three meet again? In lightning, thunder, or in rain?" But the remaining performances landed on me like so many yo mama jokes. My mom was no witch, but she might be reviled as one. Lukumi stretched back to Yoruba land, Nigeria, survived the Middle Passage and hid behind the Catholic saints of the tropics. Santeria, as they called it in the movies, created heavenly disguises for forbidden materials, in particular Yoruba cosmology and wisdom. We had accumulated ancient materials within ourselves. From them, Lukumi forged a modern path. It was an illicit history, and it was that history's disguise. Kind of like Juan Luis Guerra's honey-sweet tenor blanketing those African tumbaos. Between our hip thrusts and ceremonies, the Perezes had no choice but to braid life together from disparate global strands. Maybe, in fact, Mom's ceremonies were not wholly divorced from that 4th of July dance party. One seemed secular, the other spiritual. And yet a pulse is a pulse is a pulse. A drum is a drum is a drum. We heal, we rupture, we heal again. Many nights I had sat on the third floor, blasting The Simpsons to block out the ceremonial drums below. It was not forbidden that I attend these rituals, but explicit invitations had never been extended. Instead, I got vague warnings that something would be happening downstairs. Once I had come into the kitchen and discovered Mom struggling to clean out the turtle. Her dull knives were no match for the tough meat stuck to the shell with belligerence. Mom sweated as she worked. I nuked a cheese whiz melty and cleared out of there quick. Another time, I had peeked around the corner as she cut the chicken's jugular and blood cascaded in a molasses ribbon. Many mornings I had placed fresh espresso, many evenings hot meals at the feet of her altars. The ancestors eat first, she instructed. Occasionally, I stood in the sunroom where mom's altars were, observing the colorful fabrics and offerings, halved oranges sticky with honey and cinnamon for Oshun, a deep blue urn housing Olokun secrets, for Chango a satin red crown and mahogany axe, heaps of fresh fruit stacked in a cornucopia worthy of a Dutch still life, while rattles and brass bells and coconut shells mingled here and there. In English, the word was altar. In Spanish, the word was throne. One evening, I heard mom shriek downstairs. There was no TV volume knob that could dampen my racing pulse, my compulsion to see. Perched on the third floor landing, I cupped my ear. There were no drums that night, just the blurry urgency of a woman's voice darting upstairs. I recognized mom in the strange cadences, but she sounded stilted, distressed. I descended one step at a time, pausing, telling myself, turn back. At last, there she was, seated at the dinner table. Her voice and gait were unrecognizable. Her Spanish was only half familiar. Every sentence sounded like some Creole tongue, some pidgin dialect. And she spoke with the voice of an elder, maybe even an ancient. The body before me was hers and yet seemed inches shorter and pounds heavier. A Baba Lao fed her rum and asked questions as she channeled this outside spirit, my stepfather transcribing her answers. Stand back, Pop warned when he saw me approach, or you might get hit. I obeyed. Soon a spasm thundered mom's core. With an awful yell, she jolted up violently, sending the chair flying backwards, and then collapsed into Pop's arms. And just like that, mom was back, sweating, out of breath, hair matted to her forehead. She punched me right in the face once, Pop joked to me, fanning mom and welcoming her back to her skin. I so much wanted to take my Jewish dad's side, to join his total disavowal of any god, his assertion that religion is the root of all evil. It seemed a cleaner line of belief and had the added benefit of centuries of Catholic devastation and colonialism to bolster his assertion. I deeply wanted to see my mom's altars like my white friends saw them. What is that? They would cringe at Elegua, the trickster spirit who opened all pathways. Elegua sat quietly behind our front entrance, a cement-filled conch shell with cowries for eyes, nose, and mouth. A few pennies and a fresh shot of espresso sat in his attitude. My friends tried to cover their smirks, hide their flared nostrils and raised eyebrows. And if their parents came to pick them up, if they came inside for a minute and caught a glimpse, it was often the last time that friend came over. Oh, how I craved the luxury of a home that required no explanation, that instilled less shock. I so dearly wanted to write off mom's spirit world as gremlins of brain chemistry, to pathologize them into some diagnosis or syndrome. And yet, here was the Boricua whose National Organization of Women award hung staunchly on our living room wall. Mom had been trained by the most badass feminists in Philly, Quaker elders, Native elders, Black elders, and Boricua elders, passed their grassroots tactics onto mom, taught her to fight with peaceful ferocity. The founding fathers loomed large in Philly, but mom made sure I understand the work of our city's founding mothers. As a staff member at Choice Hotline, mom answered anonymous calls and referred women to appropriate reproductive health and family planning services. The Latino community, she worried, was particularly vulnerable. A disproportionate number of our families had no regular source of health care. Prenatal care rates were abysmal, and infant mortality in our community had reached a crisis level. But mom questioned whether OBGYN access was the only barrier. Older Latinas, she told me, might be uncomfortable discussing sexual activity and intimate health concerns with a stranger. Those most in need, she knew, probably didn't have phones. So how could a hotline help women who were scared to speak? Mom took me to the ribbon cutting of Casa Comadre, the community center she founded in response to these concerns. All stripes of women folk flocked to Casa Comadre's common room. Undocumented women who taught each other English, activist women who trained each other in fundraising, women who led bilingual reproductive health classes and nutrition teach-ins. One night, a woman delivered her newborn alone in their dark basement, scared that a hospital might initiate deportation proceedings. Well, as the woman cried between contractions, mom called lawyers and doctors. And later that night, The mother and newborn baby were hospitalized, fear-free, with legal counsel. Out of crisis, out of problem-solving, blossomed community buy-in and legal progress, one step at a time. Mom had an easy sense of humor discussing queasy topics. She drove many middle-aged Latinas to their first gynecological appointments, explaining on the car ride there what they should expect. She described a speculum in detail, how it would be inserted, and why it did not compromise their marital fidelity. "What does masturbate mean?" my little sister asked one afternoon. There was no awkward pause, not a whiff of embarrassment. "It means to have sex with yourself," Mom said plainly. This bluntness struck me as nothing short of heroic. "Ew, why would anyone want to do that?" my sister snorted. I didn't know how to see Mom's altars and awards in a single panoramic glance. How could one living room house the cachet of her activism and the blunder of her worship? Where would I draw the dividing lines between the parts of Mom that kicked ass and the parts that wore me raw with shame? How many parcels ought I divide Mom into? The priestess, the possessed, the sacrificer, the healer, the intellectual, the bootstrap statistician, all of it was her. It seemed Mom must be either a single analog existence or an infinity of complications. Rather than quantifying and ranking her character traits from whitest to weirdest, what if I looked at the charged spaces between those traits instead? Was Mom an individual precisely because of her confounding contradictions? Or was I the weird one? Were contradictions in the eye of the beholder? One summer, we flew to the Rosebud Reservation in South Dakota to participate in a Sundance ceremony. As a Taíno woman, Mom was sometimes welcomed into other Native communities, where she learned their natural healing techniques and shared her own. As we drove, the Black Hills beckoned in the distance. They were dark, low mounds. "Sacred ground," Mom pointed out. Crossing onto the res, my eyes adjusted to a poverty unlike North Philly. To me, poverty was burnt buildings, sidewalk vials, corner lots overgrown with weeds. To me, poverty was plastic sheets for windows and duct tape on a leaky ceiling. It was the cupboard's last slice of bread offered to Kiki, who had come for a visit. Mom drove in silence, so I had no choice but to witness. Our nation offered a diverse panoply of poverties. There were poverties I had not known, and ours were no worse or more urgent than others. In our rental car, we passed huts of corrugated steel and tar paper, lean-tos with neither electricity nor windows. Suddenly, I saw Odettes and Mijas and Titi Rosas crumbling homes with a strange appreciation. Mom spent most of her time in South Dakota with a Sioux elder named Hildegard. My job was to stay out of her way, so the local teens showed me the creek, asked about life in the big city, and taught me how to chew dip. The Sundance was a community-wide gathering that lasted for days. Families stretched out on the expanse of grass, spoke in respectful whispers, and shared meals. Stewed meat in sweet, clear broth arrived from a woman with long braids and a large bosom. Her white moccasins and red beadwork hardly made a sound as she walked on the grass. She placed the plastic bowl at my knees quietly. At the ceremony's center, a group of young men had pierced their chests with carved bone crescents. The bones were attached to long ribbons, which were all tethered to a central pole. The bare-chested men danced, circling the pole, connected through their left and right pectoral muscles, physically attached to the thing and so attached to each other. Their dance was one of fervent footsteps and athletic pounding, causing the earth to drum. The soil where we sat vibrated as they danced, and so by extension, the men were attached to us. The drum's resolute pulse was delivered on the breeze, bouncing from body to body, connecting us with aural stitchwork. At the ceremony's climax, the men danced backwards with strong intention, outward and outward and outward thrusting until the piercings ripped from their skin and they were physically free. I watched stunned as their chests bled a little. Blood sacrifice, it seemed, transcended my West Philly living room. Blood sacrifice, it seemed, was impervious to my voyeuristic perch and provincial qualms. It was not just Mom's method of alienating me. Here was sacrifice of the self, of the sanctity of one's own skin. Mom explained that in this way the men experienced the bloodletting of childbirth and became full in their humanity. I returned to Philly humbled. I mean, was I prepared to feel aggrieved by an entire nation? The Lakota people had offered the privilege of invitation. The Sundance was not open to outsiders. The ceremony had quieted me. Quiet, I observed, was different than silence. Quiet made room for the complicated. In quiet, one might hear one's own blood. I'm going to end with one brief section in an epilogue. How's everyone doing? The essay test. By senior year, I had developed a deep love of literature, and my tolerance for poor teaching had worn thin. I did not want to cackle like Macbeth's witches. I wanted to indict those witches and Shakespeare too, and to be indicted in return. The first day of advanced placement English, Dr. Phillips handed out the Norton Anthology of Literature, a brick of tissue-thin paper with tiny type. I cracked open the back cover and wrote my name in number 2 lead. Dr. Phillips told us to find Wallace Stevens in the index and read The Emperor of Ice Cream in silence to ourselves. A rude poem, purposeful in its arrogant nonsense. Wallace Stevens seemed to spit on Dickinson and Frost, mocking those who enjoyed linear, recognizable beauty. My mind was off at the races, arguing voraciously with Stevens, interrupted only when Dr. Phillips began to read the poem aloud. He made it sound like music. It had no logic, but soared with cadence. How could a poem be harmonious and rude all at once? Dr. Phillips never took a breath midline. I had been taught to play piano like in that manner, lifting my hands from the keys only at a melodic phrase's completion. During the longest lines, he ran out of breath, and yet he still pushed forward silently, his voice all but exhausted. Then he reached the line break, inhaled, and began the next line in full voice. He read the poem like he loved the poem. He read the lines like you write a love note. He read the words like foreplay, but not the overly serious kind, the playful kind, the beguiling kind, the silly kind. The kind of foreplay where it's next, even though you love what's happening right now. That's how he read the poem. I thought, I want to love something, anything, the way that man loves to read that poem. Flannery O'Connor was the first author, stranger than any book I had ever encountered. Here was writing that proposed a gruesome cosmology where the air tasted of molasses and gravity had fangs. O'Connor was drawn to religion and rendered it a gross, sadistic force. Though she did not play nice, even the monstrous horror with which she depicted worship smacked of respect. Our first exam of the school year arrived. Test sheets lurked face down on our desks. We flipped them over and were astonished to find just 2 sentences on the other side. Flannery O'Connor uses the theme of fire in her work. Discuss. That was it. 53 minutes, go. Extra sheets of paper, we were informed, could be found at the front of the room. Flannery O'Connor uses the theme of fire in her work. Discuss. Fire. My own mother used candles in her daily worship. She placed them beside clear cups of water and photographs of our deceased. I had lit candles for her altars, and watched over the week's course as the wax diminished and the flame descended. Fire, 1 minute down, 52 to go. There's a moment when the pen moves of its own volition, when it guides your hand, when a voice outside borrows your ink for its own swift work. I would later learn that I had gotten up 8 times, that I had filled 8 loose leaf sheets of paper that day. I would later learn that one by one, students handed in their exams and were excused, that I would be the only person remaining, still writing when the 5th period bell rang, that my essay would stop mid-sentence. I went out to the corridor and saw Central High as though it were underwater. My classmates huddled in a circle, whispering their outrage. What about multiple choice, they protested. Where were the short form questions, the true-false, the vocabulary fill-ins? They had studied the character names and town locations and vocab words in Flannery O'Connor's novellas. How were they to demonstrate their mastery in such a loose format? I kept my mouth closed, lest my secret slip to the world. It was strange, this sense that I had channeled something. It felt subterranean and animal. And though just my hand was moving, my knees did tremble, my veins did quake. I was, at last, corporeal. I had a body, and that body could dance even in stillness. I had always naively assumed that learning to dance would be joyous, but no. Sitting in a left-handed desk for Dr. Phillips' essay test, learning to dance was a terrifying initiation. I remember moving the pen with profound fear that my words were dirty, that my sentences, which stank of my gut, had mineral claws. The things I was saying sought no approval or permission. They were raw and disgusting riots of assertion. For years, I had felt aggrieved by Mom's Afro-Rican path, by her aggressive refusal to assimilate. For years, I had secretly wished that she would worship just a little bit whiter. But now I had accessed the heavier than me, the thicker than me, the dormant beast. And it had been unlocked, not by a drum, not by blood sacrifice or Juan Luis Guerra, but by a white Southern woman who wrote a short story and an English teacher wearing a bow tie and sweater vest. Soon after, I asked Mom if she had some books on Santeria I might check out. One day, Four New World Rituals by John Mason was waiting on my piano bench. Later, The Way of the Orisa by Philip J. Niemark was placed on the third floor landing. Every so often, a new book appeared, like a secret code, its receipt acknowledged only when it disappeared into my bedroom. Ofrendo a las Orichas arrived alongside a Spanish-English dictionary, hardback and bound in a handsome blue leather. In this way, Mom and I developed a clandestine exchange, ever respectful of the other's private world. Thank you. Thank you.
We have time for some questions, and I'd like to say, if it's an okay proposal with you, I'd like to have the questions come from students, undergraduate or graduate students, but we'll start with that group. Can I see a hand?
Is there a microphone?
Yeah,
oh, I see.
I was going to tell the first person that, in other words, if you're asking a question, if you'll go to the microphone.
Don't be shy.
Don't be shy. Thank you.
How you doing? I'm Kevin.
Kevin.
I'm a grad student here. I also went to Central High in Philly.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm 271.
So, 271?
Yeah.
So, 254.
Okay, see, so I guess my question just kind of relates a little bit to that. How did, you mentioned it a little bit, but the Central English Department, like, inspire your writing?
So much. You know, that Dr. Phillips' class really changed me. And I had many other great teachers there, too. And his class was so important for me that I tried to track him down many years later after I won the Pulitzer Prize, and I wanted to say thank you. I never kept in touch with him. He didn't socialize with the students that much. And I tried and tried and tried, and I kept hitting all these roadblocks, and finally it came back to me that essentially he had Alzheimer's and did not like speaking to his old students because he could not recognize them, and it was very frustrating for him. And so when I got word of that, I sent message, please let me talk to him. I don't want to be recognized. I don't care. I don't think he remembers me anyway. That, you know, I just want to say thank you. And so I kind of convinced them, and his sister, who I tracked down in Philly, and she put him on the phone and she let me talk to him. And so I said, you know, it was how I introduced myself. I don't want to be recognized. Look, you taught me. I just want to say thank you. I became a writer. You really changed my life. And he said, well, do you remember what I taught that year? And I remembered. I remembered everything and in what order. And it turned out he remembered each class by the syllabus he taught. He taught a different syllabus every year. And so I told him, and we spoke for like an hour, and I was like, did him the Emperor of Ice Cream just like he did it. I kind of imitated him, and the Canterbury Tales, he made us memorize the Canterbury Tales. All the other AP students were did not like his class because it was a hard class and you weren't guaranteed an A, but it was wonderful. I had many other good English teachers there. The, you know, the one with the witch cackling was not a highlight of my academic career, but it helps me appreciate the good teachers, too.
Thank you.
So nice to see another central person.
In Nashville, randomly.
Yeah. Anyone else?
I'm definitely not a student, but if I can be permitted a question.
Of course.
I'd love to know how your collaboration on In the Heights was done, because it's not the traditional book, music, and lyrics. It's kind of one unit. I'm just wondering how you and Miranda did that.
Well, you know, I mean, essentially what we did was we just wrote together every day for 4 years. And so when you do that with someone, it's hard to remember exactly how things went, because at a certain point, he's working on one song on the couch, and I'm working on one scene in the armchair, and then we get bored and we like swap laptops and we start like editing and deleting what the other person has done, or copying and pasting it into our own material. It's like, no, I want this lyric, I'm putting it in this scene, and then we take a pause and watch Oprah, and then we get back to writing. And you know, it's when I do this kind of writing, it's very it's so private. And it's so alone, and I find great reward in that. But one of the things I love about writing musicals is it's the opposite. It is so intensely collaborative by nature. And Lynn is one of the most collaborative and generous people I've ever met and ever worked with. And one of the tricks of it is, how do you... Do you guys know what I'm talking about if I say that, like, sometimes writing in Hollywood, and even some writing like on Broadway, feels like it's written by committee? Like, it just kind of feels kind of like, like kind of just like in the middle, like not very strong. And it's easy when you want to be a good collaborator and say yes to what your collaborators are saying, are offering, to get lost and to lose your own kind of fierce individual artistic point of view. And so that's kind of the fun dance and challenge of writing musicals, is to be completely collaborative and yet not lose your distinctive vision and voice in that collaboration, you know, because the piece will suffer for it. And, you know, so part of collaborating with Lynn was just learning his language, he learned mine, you know, and then our languages do kind of become each other's at a certain point.
Open to people over 25 now.
Yeah, do you want to come up to the mic?
When/how/why did you get into writing for theater? Like, what was it about theater that was like, I know that is not all that you write, obviously, but I'd be interested to hear that story.
For many reasons. That is the story of my life. So I always wrote as a child. That was just a hobby. It was fun for me. And then I studied music as an undergrad, and I started composing scores for dance companies, composing scores for undergrad theatrical productions. Then I wrote my own musical and wrote the script for it. Mm-hmm. And that kind of got me down that path. But I do actually think that a lot of why I do some film and TV writing. I actually just typed the end on the screenplay for In the Heights a few days ago. But I do prefer theater, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And I think in part it has to do with a little bit of what you heard about today. Like, there's something about how charged a space can become with bodies in it, that I find I have a really direct and personal relationship with. And I didn't even go, this is for a totally separate piece of writing, but my aunt, Linda Hudes, on the Jewish side of my family, she composed music for the Big Apple Circus for 20 years. She was my first music teacher. I would go to the circus every year and copy her charts. She taught me musical calligraphy, and I would copy her charts and make friends with the clowns and stuff. And so I think a childhood that's kind of steeped in clown acts and religious ceremony seems natural that I would be a playwright, right?
Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Michael. I'm double majoring currently in theater and creative writing, really looking forward to a career in playwriting, but I'm not really sure where to start outside of my classes, which I love. And I was just wondering if you had any tips to sort of build your portfolio, build your career as a student.
Sure. I mean, the first thing I would say, what year are you?
I'm a sophomore.
A sophomore. Okay, so you've got tons of time. I mean, what I would say to you is don't get overly specialized. Like, still, you're at a liberal arts school, and really take advantage of that, and really steep yourself in an interest in the world. That will fuel your writing immensely. And don't throw away the best books you've read for class. Do people buy paper books for classes here? Yeah, like, don't throw the best ones away. Keep them. They will fuel your writing in the future. You know, dog ear the pages and write your stars and do your marginalia thing. That will be a helpful resource. You know, when I don't think of it as a career in writing, though absolutely it is. You know, it's how I pay my mortgage sometimes. I also teach, and that pays my mortgage sometimes. But I do think of it as a path. It's just a daily thing. It's what you do every day until the day you decide to not do it anymore, or you die, whichever of those happens first, right? I would also say, when you get out of undergrad, do not rush into trying to do an MFA program. I just think writing comes from life, you know? And if you steep yourself too much in one practice or craft, the danger is that you can kill the joy and love for it, which is much more dangerous than not writing for a year while you do other things. So, you know, go bartend and write in the mornings, or join the Peace Corps, or, you know, whatever's going to be an adventure for you. Go do those things. And then after some years, as you've continued to write, you know, then think about grad school, or maybe you'll already be busy, you know, being produced, and you won't want to go to grad school. I don't know, but some tips.
Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Isabel. I'm a sophomore in the creative writing program and minoring in Latin American studies. And last semester, I had the opportunity to listen to Natalie Diaz read, and she talked about how her family history influenced her writing a lot, and she had to fictionalize her family in order to really love them and accept them. And I'm reading Water by the Spoonful right now, one of your works, and I noticed a lot of parallels between your family history and that play. So I was wondering how you strike the balance between real life and fictionalizing, and that relationship between your writing and your family.
Well, the play Water by the Spoonful is a work of fiction that is based on interviews with my cousins and people outside of my family also that are in the recovery community. I have a very kind of rigid set of things I do to strike a balance. Like, for instance, the character of Odessa has this terrible story that starts Act Two. I don't know how far you've gotten into the play, but that story is fictional, and it's fictional on purpose because I want the play to be fictional, and so I make fictional things happen on purpose so that if people want to snoop around, they'll see, oh, this didn't really happen. Even though there are elements that are true in the play too, I talk to my family about my intentions. I tend to not write or include family stories with anyone that I don't have a pretty good relationship with, because I'm worried how those intentions might come across. And I invite them to the, you know, I interview them, I show them the play. Sometimes they read it, sometimes they don't. In the case of Water by the Spoonful, and this was nonfiction, what I read. This is my life. The character of Odette, that's her name. That's her real name. She inspired the character of Odessa. You know, she really struggled with addiction, and it cost her a lot. It cost her a lot in her life. Now she's been recovered for decades, and she's doing really well, but she still struggles. And so I brought her up to Hartford, Connecticut for the world premiere of Water by the Spoonful. And like a minute into the thing, it was like a lot, and I was just freaking out, and I was like, oh God, I shouldn't have done this. This is gonna trigger her. I don't know, like, this was a really bad idea. She doesn't travel much. She's a very provincial person, so it's like she hadn't even been to Puerto Rico. But I dragged her up to Connecticut for this. So I said at intermission, I mean, she was shaking and like really having a hard time of it. I said at intermission, I was like, oh, that, you know, let me take you back to the hotel room. I shouldn't have done, this was ill-conceived by me. I'm sorry to have put you in this position. She was like, hell no, I want to see what's going to happen in Act Two. And I was like, oh. And then she turned to this like white fox sitting next to us, this like silver fox, and she was like, this is my story, this is about me. And she made friends, like she made friends with the woman, with like the patron next to her at opening night, and I like ran out, I was like drinking wine at intermission, I was like, oh God, this is too intense. But you know, what happened was the next morning over breakfast at the hotel, she opened up to me in ways that she hadn't at the interview. She said, you know, you really got it right, and she said, I almost didn't make it, and I wasn't going to tell you. She said, I almost did not make it here because I had, like, I got really sick, and her husband, Dwayne, he had to lock her in the bathroom because she was like, I wanted to use so badly. Mm-hmm. And he had to lock me in the bathroom for almost a day, and I was just sick on the floor of the bathroom. And, you know, she was like, that she had told him, don't open the door. Whatever you do, don't open the door. Because she lives in a neighborhood where she could just walk out her door and get some, you know, buy some drugs. And I was like, I didn't know. When I interviewed her, she did not make it clear that the cravings were that powerful still, decades later. So for me, it's there's a healing process to it, too. You know.
Thank you.
We let this gentleman's question be the last one because we can continue the dialogue at the reception. Thank you.
I was wondering, as a professor, what you enjoy teaching and what are some of the things you recommend reading?
Oh, well, I mean, the super duper fun element of being a professor is you're essentially president of your own book club. You have like total power, right? It's like, it's so powerful. And I do a rotating list. I tend to teach contemporary drama, but then I'm teaching a play this semester on writing history plays. I'm teaching a course this semester on writing history plays. And so I put some classics on. I actually put The Crucible on. And I also put Skin of Our Teeth by Thornton Wilder. And I just asked the class for a show of hands, and only half of them had read The Crucible. So I was like, oh, wow. So it made me think that I probably should be teaching more modern American, not just contemporary, because I want to make sure they've graduated and read some of these plays. But I don't know. I love so much. It's the hardest question, right? I mean, Paula Vogel was my teacher. I love her writing. I chose her as my teacher because I read her plays and was like, whatever is going on there, I want to be near that. I love Lynn Nottage. I love Sarah Rule. I love kind of the modern classics, like For Color Girls, Who Have Considered Suicide. I read that in college, and that one really threw me for a loop. That one really changed me. I read a lot of nonfiction and a lot of poetry. I just saw a show that rocked my world, which was Michelle Indegicello, who is this kind of funk bassist, led essentially a church service in which, this was at Harlem stage, she led a church service, but the text was all from James Baldwin, The Fire Next Time. And any chance I get to reconnect with Baldwin, who is probably my favorite writer, I'm there. I always learn, and I've read some of his books, I don't know, 20 times. But just read a lot.
If you want to see the full list of plays that she's using, if you go onto the Wesleyan University website,
oh yeah, my syllabi are on there, yes.
But thanks very much to all of you for being here. Thank you.
Thank you all.